In this lesson, we're going to discuss magnetism. Magnets are bipolar. Magnets always have a north and a south pole. It doesn't matter if it's a bar magnet, a button magnet, or a horseshoe magnet. All magnets always have two poles, the north pole and the south pole. You cannot cut a magnet in half and isolate a pole. That's called a monopole. You cannot create a monopole. That's impossible. When you cut a magnet in half, what happens is you create two new magnets, each one with a north and a south pole that align. And when you put those two magnets that you cut apart together, they'll attract and form the large magnet again. But magnets are always bipolar. Opposite poles attract, like poles repel. So no matter if it's a north and a north or a south and a south, like poles are always going to repel each other. Opposite poles, north and south, always attract one another. Magnetic fields, just like electric fields and gravitational fields, form around the magnet. They show where the field strength is, where the greatest forces are. Magnetic fields, just like electric fields and gravitational fields, are invisible. You can see here two magnets being pulled apart from each other. Notice at the ends of the magnets, at the poles, the field lines are close together. That indicates the strength is greater there. As you pull them apart, you can see these are a north pole and a south pole. You see how the field lines are attracted to each other. They form a solid line. And as you rotate the magnet on the right, look how the field lines, there becomes a gap in there as that like pole gets near the other pole. So as you spin it, if you would continue to spin that the entire way around, you would see a large gap between the poles because there'd be no magnetic field strength in there. There'd be no force in that field. It'd be a void. So that is a similarity between electric and magnetic fields, is that you have spots of attraction and repulsion. The repulsion is going to create no field strength within it, whereas the attraction, the field lines are going to connect. The gravitational field, remember, is only going to be an attractive field. The Earth is a giant magnet and creates its own magnetic field. Notice on this magnet that the south pole of the magnet is Earth's north pole. So Santa lives at the south pole of the magnet. If you hold a compass in Earth's field, it points from towards the Earth's north pole. The field lines go from north to south, so they're going to always point upward on your field strength. So when you put a compass, the compass points towards the magnetic south, although that is actually what we call the north pole in terms of latitude. Inside the Earth is a giant iron core, and this iron core is what creates the magnet. Iron is very magnetic, and so the Earth is just a huge magnet. Earth's magnetic field is very important. It shields us from cosmic radiation and harmful things that can happen to us. So it protects us. The Earth's field has reversed in the past. The last reversal was 780,000 years ago, and it usually reverses about every 200,000 years. Scientists figured out this by looking at the iron in rock formations. They could see that the iron went in different directions as it came out of the Earth or cooled in magma. So we are overdue for a reversal for a very long time. How magnets work. This person here is describing what happens in a magnet. So below we have a ferromagnetic material. And a ferromagnetic material is a material that's capable of being magnetized. And that is in the magnetic field of that permanent magnet above it. So as you go into this magnetic field, you can see what happens is the domains get aligned inside this magnetic field. To align those domains creates a magnet in that material below. Like if you've ever taken a magnet and picked up a paper clip and then picked up a second paper clip, the paper clip itself is not magnetic, but inside there are these groups of neighboring atoms called domains, and they're all out of alignment. Once they get into the magnetic field of the magnet, that magnet then takes those domains and lines them all up. and turns that paperclip into a temporary magnet. And then you can take a second paperclip and pick that up as well, because the strength of that field is going to extend the whole way down to that second paperclip. And then when you're holding the paperclip and you pull that top magnet away, the paperclips will stay stuck together because those domains are now aligned, creating a magnetic field. Once you drop them or shake them or do anything to them, heat them, they lose that magnetic field. It shakes up the domains. It shakes up the atoms again. Even the collisions with the air molecules are going to weaken that domain over time. You can see that here again. Ferromagnetic materials are things that contain iron. Ferrous, the root word of ferromagnetic, means iron containing. So steel, things like that, all are going to be able to be magnetized. Nickel and cobalt are also ferromagnetic materials. Domains are clusters of atoms inside that we align to make things magnetic. And you can see on A, B, and C here, random domains on the left, and A, you're not going to have any magnetic strength. B, a high order domains is going to have a nice strong magnetic field. And now as you shake it up or hit it with a hammer or drop it or whatever, as you shake up those domains, you're going to lose some of your magnetic field strength. Heat it up, anything that causes the atoms to become unaligned decreases the strength of your magnet over time. The final type of magnet we're going to look at are electromagnets. Electromagnets are magnets that are capable of being turned on and off, and they occur because current in a wire creates an electromagnetic field that's perpendicular to the wire. So if you coil that wire around a ferromagnetic material like a nail, what happens is you'll have a magnetic field that goes perpendicular to the coil. So along the shaft of the nail, so to speak. So you can turn on the current or just touch the wire to the side of the battery, and that will create a current that goes through the wire. That wire creates a magnetic field that's perpendicular to it, and the ferromagnetic material aligns its domains, and you got yourself an electromagnet. Now, the stronger the current and the more coils of wire you have, the stronger your electromagnet's going to be. So if you have a big voltage source, something that can create a lot of current, and you take the wire and you coil it and coil it and coil it and coil it, you can create a huge electromagnet, and then you can turn that on and off when you need to use it. Here are some examples of an electromagnet. We just talked about the battery and the nail. That's the most common one. Down on the left, you can see the junkyard. We're picking up all the steel at the junkyard using a huge electromagnet on a crane to move it around from one pile to the next. And in speakers themselves, they actually have small electromagnets that they pulse, they turn on and off to actually vibrate the cone to create the sound. The bullet train has electromagnets in it that accelerate the train. So there are a lot of applications for electromagnets.